I want to begin by inviting you to stand with us this morning as we begin to focus the service now on the Word of God, on singing together, on special music, and then we're going to open God's Word. Would you read with me off the screen this morning? Let us begin. And the scripture was fulfilled that says, Abraham believed God, and it was counted to him as righteousness, and he was called a friend of God. Would you bow with me in prayer, please? Our loving Father, we are so thankful for what we now know is a very, very special privilege to gather together as a church family and to worship you. Father, we are thankful that we can come even though we're encouraging folks not to shake hands, we're encouraging folks to social distance. We are so thankful that we can gather together and sing the great hymns that we love and songs that we love. Our hearts can be blessed by special music. We're thankful that we're able to open your word. And Father, as we come to worship you today, we would pray that the Holy Spirit of God would minister to our lives. We realize that these are truly different days in which we're living. And Father, as we worship you today, we would pray that our minds would not wander off, that we would not think about other things we have to do today. We would not focus on what is happening with COVID-19 in this hour. But Father, even in the midst of the crises of our nation, help us, Father, to focus today on you. Help us to focus on your word. And Father, we thank you for our bulletin, for our prayer list, for all of our missionaries, for those who are struggling with health needs. And Father, we would lift up each and every one that we find on that list today. We pray, Father, that our worship would please you this morning. In Jesus' precious name, amen. Please remain standing, and we're going to join our voices together today. And we're going to sing a hymn I think is very fitting for today. Till the storm passes by. Let's sing it together this morning. Amber is coming at this time. She's going to minister to us in special music. And then following her time of ministry to music, our praise team will come and lead us in a couple songs this morning as well. God bless.
This first song, it's a couple years old. We had this one scheduled for Easter Sunday, and then it ran out of what the cost of that, so we're making up for that now. And our second selection for this week, it's an older one, it's pretty familiar to everyone.
Lord, I've made a way.
Thank you, thank you, thank you so much, team, for leading us in worship this morning. Appreciate those good songs, the great biblical message that we really believe in. We're so thankful for folks that are here visiting with us today. There in the chair ahead of you, you'll find a visitor's card. I trust you'll just fill it out, and you can place it in the offering box in the foyer when you leave, and we would be so happy to have a record of your visit with us today here at First Baptist Church. We are continuing our study of the book of James. We're coming to James chapter 2 this morning, in verses 21 to 24. I always encourage folks to take their Bibles, open your Bibles with us, follow along as we read the passage of Scripture together today. We're dealing in this passage with the theme of how faith grows. Follow along as I read for us. Was not Abraham our father justified by works when he offered up his son Isaac on the altar? You see that faith was active along with his works, and faith was completed by his works. And the scripture was fulfilled that says, Abraham believed God, and it was counted to him as righteousness, and he was called a friend of God. You see that a person is justified by works and not by faith alone. I was reading that passage out of the ESV translation, English Standard Version of Scripture. So we come to the subject of faith, and we want to begin by asking a question so we can sort of begin to wrap our mind around the subject we want to study today. How does our faith grow? Folks have often asked the question, Pastor, I've been saved for 5 years. I've been saved for 10 years. I've been saved for 20 years. In fact, Pastor, there are still some things that I'm struggling with in my life. How can I get better? And really, that is a very honest question. That is a very common question. And I would answer anyone that asks that question by telling them, you aren't missing anything. You need to understand that we all wonder the very same thing from time to time. People sometimes will say, Pastor, why is it taking me so long to get better? Here are a few examples of things that I've heard. Pastor, I thought by now I would not struggle so much with anger. Why is it taking me so long to get better? Sometimes when people are honest with me, men in particular, they will say, Pastor, I still get tempted with pornography. Why is it taking me so long to get better? Others have said, Pastor, I go to church every Sunday, but I still have doubts. Why is it taking me so long to get better? Sometimes people will say, I thought by now I would be a better person. But Pastor, I am still struggling with bad habits. Why is it taking me so long to get better? And sometimes people, in their complete transparency and their honesty, they will say to me, Pastor, I don't even want to tell you this, but I'm a bitter person. Even though I cover it up most of the time, why is it taking me so long to get better? Many of us wish that we had the answer to all those questions, don't we? Sometimes we assume that once we receive Jesus Christ as our personal Savior, that life's going to be a bed of roses. No. It does not work like that. God has ordained that even though we are being conformed into the image of Jesus Christ, even though we are being made like Jesus, it only happens a little bit at a time. And sometimes that little bit seems so very, very little indeed. One of my favorite hymns to sing is There's Victory in Jesus. Aren't you thankful for that great hymn, the great message? There's awesome victory in Jesus. But victory does not come quickly. And quickly does not come easily. And the answer is because we are at war with a spiritual foe who will not yield the ground that they have in our lives. And here in our series on James, we have now come to a passage that helps us understand how God builds our faith through the trials of life. Abraham's dynamic faith was made complete when he offered his beloved son Isaac on the altar. You say, Pastor, I'd like to see my faith grow. Well then, let's study together this particular passage of Scripture to learn from Abraham's life how trials can make our faith complete. Notice again in our study, verse 21. Was not Abraham, our father, justified by works when he offered up his son Isaac on the altar? Now let's stop and think about it this morning. Let's review. Who was James writing to? We know that James was writing to Jewish believers who were facing severe persecution. And it really, I'm going to say it was a masterstroke that he chose this illustration. But really, we know that all Scripture was written under divine inspiration of God. Amen? So it wasn't just a masterstroke of luck. But the Holy Spirit of God allowed James, in writing to these Jewish believers who were facing difficulties and trials and struggling, maybe even having doubts about their newfound faith, he pulls an Old Testament example that the Jewish believers would really understand. When I say that, because the Jews trace their spiritual lineage back to Abraham. And as far as the Jews were concerned, Abraham was the ideal man of faith. After years of walking with God, Abraham was put to the supreme test of his life. It was such a traumatic moment that James says in this text that he was justified by works when he offered up his son Isaac on the altar. Now, rather than retell this familiar story, I'd like to just make some observations. So, first I need to point out for all of us this morning, that the test came many years after he had been walking with God. Please understand that. In fact, when you look at Abraham's life, his whole life was one test after another test. Sort of like our lives, amen? We got saved and there's one test after another test after another test after another test. It started when God called him to leave Ur of the Chaldees. Hebrews 11 chapter, the 11th chapter verse 8 points out for us that he left, and you know the passage, not knowing where he was going. That in itself was a huge test. And then Genesis chapter 15 and verse 6 spells out the moment when Abraham believed God and when his faith was counted as righteousness. It says, when was Abraham? We know, we talked about when was he saved? When we think of it in a New Testament sense, and the answer would have to be Genesis chapter 15 and verse 6. That's the point that the Apostle Paul makes in Romans chapter 4. That it took place approximately, think about this, 30 years before the experience that we're looking at this morning. Here's something else you need to understand. Second, the test came after Abraham had experienced both victories and defeat. We see his faith shining when he left Ur of the Chaldees. Then, in that very same chapter, we discover that when he took Sarah to Egypt, what's the first thing he did? He lied. He lied. Who was Sarah? Sarah was his what? His wife. Who did he say she was? His sister. Then, in the next, in chapter 14, he won a great victory and was blessed by Melchizedek. And then in the next chapter, chapter 15, he received a great promise from God. And then in the next chapter, he got into trouble by trying to have a child with Hagar. And you say, boy, Pastor, I sort of forgot some of this. And then when we come to chapter 17, he was circumcised. And then in chapter 20, he lied about Sarah again. So we need to understand this morning, Abraham was, yes, a man of faith, but Abraham was also a man of human weakness. Did you hear what I just said? A man of faith and a man of human weakness. The third test came in a most unexpected way. When God called him to go to Mount Moriah, Abraham had absolutely no idea of what God intended. Abraham had no reason to imagine that God would want him to sacrifice his own son. Nothing in his experience with God could have prepared him for this moment. And then fourthly, the test was never repeated anywhere else in the Bible. This is the only time that God asked anyone to sacrifice his son. And as such, it stands alone in the scriptural record. So, thinking of these four things this morning, how should we view it in light of Abraham's life? Well, the experience we're going to look at this morning stands as the supreme and the most extreme example of faith. God meant to put Abraham on the spot by asking him to yield to the Lord the son who was himself the embodiment of God's promises. Hebrews 11, chapter 19 tells us, Abraham believed that even if he put his own son to death, that somehow God would raise him from the dead. There's an interesting verse in the 11th chapter, verse 19. He considered that God was able even to raise him from the dead, from which, figuratively speaking, he did receive him back. Now, in this verse in Hebrews 11, we learn something that is only hinted at in Genesis chapter 22. Twice back in this chapter, Abraham shares that he expects that somehow and in some way, God was going to work things out so that his son Isaac would live. It's interesting, when Abraham saw Mount Moriah in the distance, he gave this instruction to his servants in Genesis 22. It says, then Abraham said to his young men, stay here with the donkey. I, the boy, will go over there and worship and come again to you. Did you get it? Do you see what the verse says? And come again to you. Abraham believed he and his son would somehow return together. And then as the two of them walked along with Isaac carrying the wood for the sacrifice, Isaac asked his father a question. And the question is this. Isaac said to his father Abraham, my father. And he said, here I am, my son. He said, behold, the fire and the wood, but where is the lamb for a burnt offering? And Abraham's reply in the very next word, verse, speaks to us of the faith that he was experiencing, even in a hopeless human situation. He replies, God will provide for himself the lamb for a burnt offering, my son. Isn't that an interesting response? Talking about faith this morning. The writer of Hebrews tells us why Abraham could talk like that. Abraham, I believed that God could raise the dead. He didn't know how. He'd never seen it happen. He reasoned from what he knew about God to what he knew about the situation, and the only thing that he could come up with was, I'm going to put my own son to death, and then God will raise my son from the dead. By the way, that's pretty fantastic when you think about it. Just ponder that. Remember, this happened 2,000 years before Christ. So let's just glean three thoughts that's really going to help us this morning. Here's the first thought. You can fill in the blanks in your take-home sheet. Faith perfected. And we look again at Scripture, verse 22. James writes, you see that faith was active along with his works, and faith was completed by his works. What was at stake at Mount Moriah? It wasn't just the life of Abraham's beloved son Isaac. There was a lot more at stake. When Abraham raised that knife with his son on the altar to kill his own son, he was also, in effect, killing the promise of God. If Isaac died, the promise of a great nation would die with him. We could almost call this the reverse of the temptation Abraham faced when he slept with Hagar. That was an attempt by Abraham to fulfill God's promise through purely fleshly means. In that case, Abraham refused to wait for God's solution. He decided to take it in his own hands at Sarah's encouraging to go and sleep with Hagar. But in this case, Abraham doesn't try to reason out how God will fulfill his promise if Isaac is dead. Abraham determined he was going to obey God without asking, how in the world is this going to ever work out? Now here's something interesting. You and I today, we are looking at this from an entirely different perspective. Totally different. Abraham was living it. We're looking back at Scripture, and we're seeing how Abraham responded in faith. Did God ask Abraham to sacrifice his son Isaac? Yes, he did. Was it a legitimate request? Yes, it was. Did Abraham know in advance how the story would end? No. Did he know about the ram in the thicket? No. Well, what did Abraham know? He knew that God had asked him to sacrifice his son. He knew that God had promised to give him a son through whom God would bless the world. What he did know was how God was going to reconcile his promise to bless the world through his son Isaac and his command to offer Isaac as a sacrifice. It is at this point that we see Abraham's faith at its very best and at its highest. Even though this command made absolutely no sense from the human perspective, Abraham intended to obey God and do exactly what God told him to do. Even though, think about it, it meant killing God's promise. My special friends, here is a lesson for all of us. When God makes a promise, and his book is full of promises, when God makes a promise, it is folly, it is disbelief to wonder how God is going to keep his word. Listen, every promise that God has ever made, he has fulfilled. And there are still some promises to be fulfilled. And we can trust the Lord that he will fulfill those promises. Now, let's move on to that second point. Here's faith affirmed. Look at the text, verse 23. And the scripture was fulfilled. I like that. Let me stop there. Aren't you thankful that all the scripture is going to be fulfilled? Amen? All the scripture is going to be fulfilled. Sometimes you might watch the news and say, I don't know how this all fits. Don't worry about it. Just believe the Bible and obey the Bible, because all Scripture is going to be fulfilled. And the Scripture was fulfilled that says, Abraham believed God, and it was counted to him as righteousness, and he was called a friend of God. Basically, Abraham believed God. When he believed God, his faith was credited to him as righteousness. And we discover that Abraham was saved, or he was reckoned righteous, on the simple and single condition that Abraham believed what God had said. How are you and I saved today? We believe that if we place our faith and trust in the Lord Jesus Christ as our personal Savior, that we will become a part of the family of God. Amen? Amen. That's what we believe. And so the offering of Isaac came many, many, many years later. Many scholars believe probably 30 years later. And the sequence is this. Abraham believed God, Genesis 15. Abraham offered Isaac as a sacrifice in Genesis 22. So it is perfectly fair to say Abraham was justified by faith. That's the argument that the Apostle Paul makes in Romans chapter 4 and in Galatians chapter 3. It's also true Abraham was justified by works, because the offering of Isaac was a demonstration of the reality of his faith. Now thirdly, let's look at faith clarified. Verse 24. You see that a person is justified by works and not by faith alone. Now let's just stop, because this is a verse that throws people off. If you don't understand all the verses around it, if you just go to this one verse and sort of lift it out of context, you're not going to really truly understand what God's Word is teaching. Faith has more than one meaning in the New Testament. Faith can refer to a body of doctrine. We can quote Scripture, we can quote the faith once delivered to the saints. That's a body of doctrine. Faith can also refer to a living trust in God. The Bible says that faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. When we talk about faith today, we sometimes mean something like a positive feeling that something's going to work out. Let me illustrate. It may be a good illustration or it may be a bad illustration. I don't know. You can choose. I've got faith that the Steelers will win the Super Bowl this year. Now, I told you it may be a good illustration or it could be a bad illustration. Now, that sentiment, that may really come true this season. They may win the Super Bowl. I hope they do. While I think about that, I don't deny it takes faith to believe the Steelers will win it all this year. I hope they do. Whatever you call that sort of faith, it is not the same thing as saving faith. Are you with me? True saving faith springs from a transforming trust in the eternal promises of a God that cannot lie. Amen? That's true saving faith. Said another way this morning, the faith that saves us, you and me, starts with God and not with us. It is a conscious choice to reach out and trust the promises of God that come to us through the death and the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. That sort of faith is alive because it rests on the living words of the living God of the universe. It's not as if James in this passage is saying, you should let your faith change you. He's going further than that. He says this, true faith will change you. That's the faith that James is talking about. For 2,000 years, Christians have seen in this story of Abraham and Isaac a picture of the death and the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. In Genesis 22, we see what a man would do for the love of God. But at Calvary, we see what God would do for the love of man. Do you see the difference? Abraham was only asked to sacrifice Isaac. God actually sacrificed his only begotten son. More than that, Jesus endured physical death and spiritual death to obtain redemption for sinners. When God's hand basically was raised at Calvary, there was no one to cry out, "Stop! Do the child no harm!" There was no ram that was caught in the thicket. There was nothing to take the place of the Lord Jesus Christ. And so you and I know that God's hand fell in judgment on his own son. We know that the Bible teaches that Jesus died for you and for me. Think about it this morning. Abraham offered his son. The father offered his son. Isaac carried the wood. Jesus carried the cross. Isaac was laid on the altar. Jesus was nailed to the cross. Abraham was willing to put his son to death. The father willed his son should die. The ram was offered in the place of Isaac. Christ was offered in the place of sinners. Abraham received his son back figuratively. Jesus literally rose from the dead. Now think about it. Think about it this morning. What are we supposed to take away from the story of Abraham and Isaac? You know, as you study Genesis chapter 22, if you look at it very carefully, you will be struck by something that God said to Abraham after this great trial was over. It was something that God said to Abraham after the ram was sacrificed. It was something that God said to Abraham after Isaac was spared. It was something that God said to Abraham that the promise was reaffirmed. And it comes as a part of the happy ending to a very great trial. God commends Abraham by saying, "You have not withheld from me your son, your only son." God says, "I asked for your most precious possession, and you gave it to me." And the real lesson this morning for all of us comes down to this. God intends to bring our faith to completion. The only way that is ever going to happen is for us to go through times of trial. Think of it this way this morning. Suppose you like to play chess. You're not very good at it. So you go to town, go into a store, and you buy one of those computer games that teaches you how to play chess. You work at it. You study it. You play those simulated games day after day after day. Eventually you get so good at it that you never lose. You are undefeated in your own basement. You're playing against a computer program. That is indeed a great, great kind of mastery. I will give you credit. But it's something entirely different to sit down at a table and play against another person that is across the table from you. That's when you really find out how good you are. And in a sense, walking with God means that eventually our faith must become more than just a theory. At some point in our Christian life, we've got to get out of the basement and we've got to get into real life. And I'm going to tell you up front, I'm going to be honest with you, sometimes we win. But there's something else I have to tell you. Sometimes we lose. It's true. Did Abraham win all the time? No, he did not win all the time. Even though he's the father of faith in the Bible, he lied about Sarah twice, and he got involved with Hagar, a situation that came about because his faith was weak, and he thought he needed to help God out. Friends, have you lived long enough to discover you never have to help God out? God doesn't need my help. God doesn't need your help. God tested Abraham over and over and over again. And God is doing the very same thing with you and with me. He is testing us over and over and over again. Why? That's the only way that our faith will grow. A beloved hymn contains these lines. Take my silver and my gold, not a mite would I withhold. Abraham's ultimate test was not about money. It touched something much deeper. Would he withhold his only son from the Lord? I'm not sure how good I'd have done in that situation. Just happens that my two sons that live in Michigan are here in the service this morning. But there's one thing that I'm thankful for. I don't have to be like Abraham. You don't have to be like Abraham. His tests are different than my tests. His tests are different than your tests. But the real question is this morning. Will you, will I, will we yield what we hold dear to our Heavenly Father? That's the real question. Just as Abraham didn't know what God was about to ask, we have absolutely no idea what the rest of the day is going to hold for us. We don't know what God may ask of us tomorrow. We don't know what God may ask of us this week. We have no idea what God may ask for next month. But we do know this. God puts us in hard places so that our faith will grow under pressure. Maybe you're here this morning and you'd say, Pastor Dan, you have absolutely no idea of the hard place I'm in this morning. Maybe you've never shared it with anybody. Maybe you've just been crying out to the Lord, oh Lord, help me. Can I just remind you that we are justified by faith? The scripture gives that to us very clear. We are justified by faith when we first place our faith and trust in the Lord Jesus Christ. And this passage teaches that we are justified by works as our faith is put to the test over and over and over and over throughout our lifetime. We should not be surprised to discover that the road to heaven is a road as believers that's filled with danger, and it's filled with trials, and it's filled with challenges. We didn't get saved and we're on the bed of roses going to heaven. God is stretching our faith all the time. It's all part of God's plan to bring our faith to completion. Remember this song? Take my silver and my gold, not a mite, but I withhold.